in the center of our discussion today is a company called Adama, recently was named Adama, and Adama is known more in, I think, steel. Okay, you're in the middle of the rebranding exercises, Machteshi Magan Industries, and a provider of crop protection solutions with more than 3,000 employees all over the world, profitable company with revenues of more than $3 billion as of 2013. The company has roots in Israel, was established in the 50s, and the twist in the game, which makes our discussion today interesting in many ways, is the fact that since 2011, the company is there's a controlling interest of ChemChina in the company, 60%, and the company is contemplating a global IPO. The story of Adama, and that's why we were so happy when we Chen agreed. I guess Chen would be the right way. No, that's it. Solved the problem. Solved the problem for the Chinese. So I guess. And I noticed that the chairman, Mr. Yang, okay, refers to you as Chen. So that makes you almost a Chinese. The story is fascinating because it raises the issue of national identity, of global corporates, Israeliness and globality, as well as the strategy of a hungry, up-and-coming company vis-a-vis the incumbent. So, as I said, to introduce Adama, we're fortunate to have with us Dr. Chen Lichtenstein, who joined management of Adama in 2006 and looked after corporate development and capital market when he joined the company. Recently was appointed as the CEO and president, and it was mentioned already by Professor Klafter. In 2013, he was appointed as a president and CEO of China National Agrochemical Corporation, CNAC, which is ChemChina's strategic business division and parent of Adama and several Chinese business groups. Concurrently with this appointment, Chen remained deputy CEO of Adama, responsible for the group China integration and the build-up activities that led eventually to the acquisition of Adama or Machteshi Magan by ChemChina, as I said, in 2011. 2009, Chen established and ran the company's the group's global resource division, and which spanning the worldwide operations, R&D, manufacturing, procurement, and supply chain. Before he joined Adama, Chen served as executive director of investment banking at Goldman Sachs in New York and London. And at the beginning of his career, he was a lawyer, was a career clerk at the Israel Supreme Court, and joined the Yigal Arnon law firm before he headed to Stanford, where he got his joint doctorate in business and law. Before that, he got undergraduate degree in physics, BSc, and LLB from the Hebrew University of Jerusalem. So, Chen, please.
Yeah.
Let me hook you up.
Almost until my kindergarten. Thank you.
Okay.
Good evening. It's very nice being here with you. You hear me okay? No. Better now? I hope.
Okay.
Okay. Is it better now?
Yeah.
I hope so. So it's very nice being here. I think the connection was created through our sister of India, who was somehow connected to the university. And of course, we have great relationship with Yossi and with the team relating to China. I was very lucky to be in the one of the inauguration ceremonies for the joint venture between Tel Aviv University and Tsinghua. And I think it's really wonderful what you're doing in terms of getting connected with China, and I'll get back to it later on. So what we thought of doing is just starting with a short clip about Adama, and then we'll jump into an introduction of the company, and we'll come into the connection with China. So hopefully it will be entertaining for you. Interesting.
Let me be your
helper.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. If things can go wrong, they will.
Sector, in fact, there are something like 600, and we sell more than 300, but the number of active ingredients which are managed centrally is 120. So just to compare, people here know about Teva. Teva is the number one off-patent player in the world for medicines for people. We're pretty much the same thing for plants. So many times people confuse us with fertilizer companies. Fertilizers are food for plants, and we provide medicines. So it's a different type of business. Our business is fully regulated. Each product which is sold around the world needs to have a registration. Okay, so basically each product is like a medicine. It has a registration, and we can only sell it under registration in each given country. So in total, we have many formulations for each active ingredient. So we're talking about more than 14,000 registrations on a global basis. Each one is a file with field trials, regulation, and so forth. Total sales, as was mentioned, is above 3 billion. We operate in more than 50 countries directly and sell in more than 120 countries. We're the number one manufacturer and distributor of branded off-patent crop protection products. Again, as I said, like Teva is on pharmaceuticals, we are for pharmaceuticals for plants. And we're the seventh largest agrochemical company in the world. This is the growth of the company since 2004. You can see that with one exception in 2009, unfortunate year, which I was also a part of the company. This was the only year in the last two decades that the company did not grow. With that exception, we're continuing to grow almost every quarter versus the previous year and every year. Versus the industry, here you can see since 1993, the growth pattern of the company, again with this unlucky event here. So uninterrupted growth for decades. This is a very strong manifestation of the strength of the industry. Crop protection products are critical. They don't smell so well. They are costly. They require expertise to apply. But without them, as you saw in the clip, the production will go down in most cases by 50% and in some cases by 70%. And the world runs on grain inventories of about 3 months. So if the world will stop using crop protection products and we all go organic, we stop eating in 3 months. The growth has been faster than the industry. This is the pace of growth of the industry, and that's the growth of our company, which has been led very successfully by Agan and Machteshim separately, and then in 1998, Machteshim and Agan combined became Machteshim Agan Industries, and this year, earlier this year, we rebranded ourselves as Adama. The split of our products, from a geographical perspective, the two biggest regions are the Americas, with very strong presence also in Brazil, and then Europe, both North and South Europe. The other big region, a bit smaller than the other two, is the Asia Pacific and Africa, and Israel is only about 3.5% of our sales today. In terms of split by product type, we have more than half of our sales herbicides, so products that deal with weeds, and then the remaining pieces are insecticides and fungicides, again, to deal with issues of crops, of plants, whether it's insects or fungus. The global presence, as I mentioned before, is in over 120 countries, and we have direct selling subsidiaries in more than 50. This was created over many years through acquisitions and organic establishment of entities that was done even before Machteshim and Agan combined. They started creating joint distribution businesses around the world, firstly owned 50-50 by Machteshim and Agan, and later on Machteshim and Agan was created and everything was consolidated into one company. These are the, as I mentioned before, we're number 7 in the industry, and these are the first 6 companies that are ahead of us in terms of total sales. If we compare by number of active ingredients per company, we can see that the number of active ingredients that we offer is greater, only the ones that are centrally managed, the 120, greater than any of our peers, any of our larger peers, which means that we are much more diversified, and we basically create off-patent versions of products that were initially developed by them after the patent expires. That's the main business, and we're doing it very successfully over a long period of time. We're the capabilities of the company span from direct sales in all the countries that you saw before, registration, which is a key competitive advantage. So we have registration teams that know how to register products in Argentina, in Germany, in Australia, in each one of the countries in which we operate, in each one of the countries in which we sell. This is a very special expertise. It's different languages, different types of approach, different restrictions, different regulation that we need to master. Then we can also reverse engineer the product. So we have we're moving from the agronomical capabilities, registration capabilities on the selling end, so dealing with the farmers, and then into the manufacturing and sourcing, which is chemistry. So we combine agronomical expertise with chemical expertise. And the chemical expertise go into manufacturing, synthesis of active ingredients, formulation of active ingredients, chemical R&D to reverse engineer the processes of the original manufacturers, sourcing, quality and everything. So we're basically an end-to-end solution provider that goes from the market to a production of the active ingredients. In the last decade, there was a huge jump in the restriction, in the requirements in Israel and elsewhere in the world in terms of environmental operations. And we have upgraded all of our facilities to top-notch standards in a very quick way. So things that were done in for European peers of ours like Bayer or Syngenta over decades, we had to make the whole step, the whole jump within 10 years. And this created, again, a competitive advantage that we can apply today as we move to take over operations in countries like China. We've improved dramatically everything that we have in terms of Maala corporate ranking. We have corporate responsibility procedures that we apply in a very strict manner. So the whole company moved very fast in the last decade to move from being a relatively underdeveloped situation to really top-notch, definitely in Israel and also from a global perspective. The identity that we've started—it's okay—the identity that we started seeing in the film, we started as two companies, Mahtashim and Agan. In fact, we started even before the start of the nation. By chemists from universities in Israel and abroad who started a small business and then split into two groups. This is the some of the activities of setting up Mahtashim and later on Mahtashim Darom, which is today Neot Chovav or Ramat Chovav, south of Be'er Sheva. Agan was started also at the same time. And the two companies grew independently, where Agan focused mostly on herbicides and Mahtashim on insecticides and fungicides. Then, as I mentioned, they started creating a network of joint distribution companies around the world because they realized that the portfolios match and combine into a stronger one. And then in 1998, the two companies merged into Mahtashim Agan Industries. And essentially now, in the last several years, what we created is we created one culture, one identity, one approach, one company across all of our companies around the world. So we used to have companies, for example, our company in Brazil is called Millennia. Now we are rebranding it Adama Brazil. Our company in Germany was called Fine Chemie. Now we're rebranding Adama, Germany, and so forth. So the whole group was created piecemeal. And now we're, in the last several years, we're creating one corporate culture, which includes several elements. Firstly, we worked on identifying our core purpose, which is creating simplicity in agriculture. We chose simplicity as something that we feel strongly identified with. It's a simple business mentality, things that we do, things that we offer. The way that we approach the customers is trying to make their lives simple. And this was a major thing that we developed throughout the group with hundreds of our people in the last several years. And then we identified four key values. These things, when you listen to them in business school, it seems like very abstract, very artificial. But when you actually work it out in sessions with hundreds of your people, you get connected to these things. So things like empowerment of our people is very important. We operate in a very decentralized way throughout our subsidiaries in the different countries. And getting things done, the simplicity notion, these things were worked out with a lot of debates, internal debates. And the end outcome is something which is very powerful because people start understanding the common identity, common direction, common approach, see the common elements rather than the splitting elements. And this is now critical for us as we are planning to absorb from our Chinese parent operations with another 5,000 employees. So we're now 4,500. We're going to have another 5,000. And we want to maintain a stable corporate culture. So these elements really help. And then the brand that we've launched earlier this year and we're now rolling out worldwide, the Adama brand. You can see here, this is some of the ways that we started thinking about the logo. And this is our logo. In a way, this is the Adama new logo, which is very simple. It's like the letter A. That's our new logo. We're very excited about it and we're rolling it out now globally. So at the end, maybe we'll show a short clip about the new brand. Now let's talk a little bit about China. In 2010, we signed a strategic agreement with the ChemChina Group to acquire a controlling stake in Adama. So that's our group, our company. ChemChina acquired 60%, and IDB through Coor. They used to own close to 50% and then sold to ChemChina 7% and came down to 40% of the shares. So the company was taken off the public market. We used to trade in Tel Aviv Stock Exchange. And this is the ownership structure today. We're committed to taking the company back to be floated, most likely in New York, either later this year or early next. And the notion is that by the time of the IPO, we will sign an agreement with ChemChina to acquire from ChemChina all their relevant agrochemical operations. So we're going to be buying from ChemChina the order of magnitude of $900 million to $1 billion size business that will be adding one extra third on top of the $3 billion that we are today. As I mentioned before, we're talking about 5,000 employees on top of the 4,500 that we have today. And this transaction is expected to be signed this year. We identified the relevant assets of ChemChina. We selected them, and now we're going to be acquiring them, integrating them into our company, and then IPOing the company. So it's a very, very special setup where we became controlled by a Chinese group. A few words about ChemChina. ChemChina is maybe today the largest chemical group in China. It's 100% owned by the central government through the SESAC, which is the state-owned regulator that owns all the centrally owned corporation. ChemChina has grown from nothing. It was basically created about 10 years ago. 10 years ago, and grew to become the leading chemical manufacturer in China, number 355 in the global Fortune 500 list. Sorry. Through more than 100 domestic acquisitions and global acquisitions, international acquisitions in Australia, in France, UK, Norway, and Israel. So a number of successful global acquisitions. The Blackstone Group is a 20% shareholder in one of ChemChina's strategic business divisions, which is called Blue Star. And IDB is also a partner of ChemChina. So Blackstone has 20% of Blue Star and 80% belongs to ChemChina. Thank you. Just like IDB owns 40% of Adama and the 60% ChemChina. So the group is very global in its approach, very entrepreneurial, and very active on the M&A front, both domestically and outside of China. So basically, becoming part of such a group forced us to understand better what China is. And I think a lot of people sitting here probably know more than the average business person about China. So when we meet with people, sometimes even people from the top consulting companies who come to ask to work for us, and they say, we want to help you in China. And we start asking them very simple questions. So what do you really know about China? It's the biggest country in the world. It's going to become the biggest economy in the world. But in fact, if we really think about very simple questions, we find that we're quite ignorant about this. It's a little bit like it's a different universe altogether. So questions like, when will China's economy surpass the United States economy? People used to think it's going to happen in a decade or two. The answer is, most likely before the end of this decade. You go to a Chinese airport and you see the Airbus 380s landing and you wonder where they're flying. You say maybe to Los Angeles, maybe to New York. No, from Beijing to Chengdu. They introduced these planes before British Airways did. And some of the domestic airlines in China are twice as large as Lufthansa and the fleets are completely modern. You look at the train infrastructure in China. There is no continent on the planet that has an advanced train infrastructure as China has. Not Europe, definitely not the United States. Nothing like what exists in China. And we, to a great extent, are ignorant. Another question. Who knows the name of the Chinese Prime Minister? Hence, who knows the name? Who knows the name of the French president? Who knows the name of the German chancellor? I'm not asking you now who knows the name of a province in China. Hubei province, Jiangsu province. I didn't ask that because this is the size of Germany. I'm asking you the name of the prime minister of the largest nation on the planet. The number one economy in the planet before the end of the decade, and you don't know the name. Amazing. So we're basically looking at the most important development in our lifetime from an economic perspective, and we shut our eyes. We don't want to see it. It's an amazing, amazing phenomenon. Amazing. For intelligent people, educated people all over the world. So here's the Prime Minister of China. He's the number two. I did not ask the name of the president. I thought maybe more of you will know the name, but I think it's also not a great score. And this is not just for this group. It's always the same. So we basically did a lot of thinking and studying about China. We had to. What we learned is that there is a huge spectrum of opportunities for us in this country. Because of the huge size of the country, the fact that the Chinese people need to provide food for themselves, the focus on agriculture is paramount. In terms of research and development, the seed industry, formulation, and the agrochemical space as well. So our industry that we described before, you know, the six big players and ourselves as number seven, number one off patent. If we look at China, China has many agrochemical makers. None of them has presence outside of China, almost none. So they are basically working within China. There are more agrochemical makers in China alone than the agrochemical in the whole world put together. So China and the world, just like in many other aspects, also in our industry, are like two separate universes. There is the universe of China, which is isolated to a great degree, and there is the universe of everything else. And the size of the universe is about the same. So number of companies, complexity, ability to manufacture advanced chemicals is very, very advanced in China, but nobody from China has actually ventured out. So most Chinese companies have no registrations. I mentioned before, to sell a product in Argentina, you need a registration in Argentina. Almost no Chinese company has a single registration outside of China, and also vice versa. The global companies are very, very careful in terms of what they're doing in China. They are concerned about people taking away some of their IP. So everybody's treating each other in a very kind of delicate way. Our unique situation, where we're owned by a centrally controlled government entity of China, makes us very special in China. Because on the one hand, we're international. We're coming from the outside with our thinking, with our way of doing business, with our technologies. But we're fully supported by the central government. So things that we do, when we sign a contract, people see us, but they also see Chem China. So it's much easier to do business in this huge and attractive market. I know that there is a lot of talk today in Israel about the benefit and disadvantages of being becoming a part of a Chinese centrally owned enterprise. We see huge value in that. And the Chinese, and this is something that Tel Aviv University is leading in, have huge, tremendous respect for Israeli innovation, Israeli thinking. You know, there is this saying that all the big religions came from here, right? Judaism, Islam, Christianity, and Marxism. That's the way they think about it. So all four of them. So after learning about the opportunities that China offers to us, both in terms of market, China today is a $4.5 billion agrochemical market, which is growing 10% a year. So China, within the next decade, will become one of the top agrochemical markets in the world, the same size of the Brazilian market, the United States market, and the European market. So it's a critical market which is not penetrated enough by the global players. So if we are today coming into a market like the United States, and we see the big six companies are already controlling 70% of the market, and we need to penetrate and grow our share, in China, the big six companies altogether are less than 30% of the market. So there's much greater opportunity for us to grow. Plus, we're going to be buying the relevant assets of Chem China, so we will have an excellent platform to grow from in the domestic market, which is going to be one of the most important ones globally. Plus, of course, getting access to technologies, building modern manufacturing plants and so forth for export for the world. So in our thinking, what we saw before, we started with identifying our purpose, our values, brand and so forth, but we also charted our strategic long-term direction for the group. And as you can see, our employees, our people, chose, after learning what China offers to us, chose one of the most important pillars of our strategy and strategic direction from China forward. So what we mean by that is we have the chance to become a number one player, not a number seven player, a number one player in a market which has the potential to become one of the top global markets. So from our perspective, it's an opportunity to move from being a follower in the industry to a leader in the entire industry, not to mention the commitment that Chem China has made to us in terms of financial support for additional global acquisitions. So the ability to connect to China, both as a market and as a source for export and financially, is huge, huge. So this is why this is one of the critical pillars in our long-term strategy. The other two important pieces are building our hybrid offering. This is the offering of products. This is also connected to China, and also the digital space as a way to access the market. I'm sure many of you know Alibaba, know these companies. Alibaba, you know the size of Alibaba? I'm sure anyone who's reading about the upcoming, their upcoming IPO, the size of the volume of trades on the Alibaba platform, which is entirely within China, is more than Amazon and eBay put together. So when we think about technology, about digital in China, China is leading the digital space in the world. Many farmers that don't have a car, they have smartphone, and they can get information about products on their phone. They can take a snapshot of a disease in their field and transmit it to somebody sitting in a lab elsewhere to identify the issue that they're facing and to recommend some solution. This is what we set out to do in China. That's the From China Forward strategic direction. We're basically aiming to build distribution leadership in the Chinese growing market. So being a top player in a top market globally, which will help us to change the mindset of our company to be much, much more aggressive in the global domain. Strong China supply chain capabilities to export from China to the world, some of our products. Improved product portfolio. Tapping into the knowledge in China and bringing our knowledge to share with our colleagues in China, and complementary R&D resources and capabilities. We're now working on setting up an R&D hub in China, and new synthesis facilities and new formulation facilities for the Chinese market and for the world that will support our operational backbone worldwide. So basically, lastly, it's just a clip on our new brand. I hope you enjoy it, and then if you have any questions, I'll be very happy to take them.
We have grown from a single patch of land in the desert. Growing is in our heart, and it's what we passionately helped farmers do for more than 70 years. Working together with our partners, we have put farmers first to meet their needs. And that's how we have become one of the world leaders in crop protection. Striving to create simplicity in agriculture drives us to do things differently, daring to innovate and offering a vast range of crop protection solutions. By joining our agri-digital community, we believe that farmers around the world can share knowledge and expertise to predict and prevent risks and forecast opportunities. Leveraging the advantages of collaboration between East and West enables us to deliver the precise solution at exactly the right time to farmers in every corner of the world. It's time to grow smarter, to grow further. It's time to simply grow together. Adama.
Thank you.
Okay, according to, you said you will entertain questions. Let me open the stage. Please, one of our Brazilian friends, please go ahead.
Question about the strategic move has been made to merge those two companies and then take it off the market, put it on the market again. So who led that? Was this the Israeli company that looked for a Chinese company, or was it the other way around? I'm just curious.
ChemChina has been looking to acquire a global presence in agrochemicals for several years before we really got together. So my first indirect meeting with ChemChina was when we were trying to buy one of our peer companies in another country, and I flew over to meet with the CEO of that company, And he told me, well, you won't believe. Just yesterday, we had an uninvited a delegation who basically they were invited to an investment bank in their hometown. And in that office, when they came to the investment bankers, waited some Chinese delegation. And they put an offer on the table. And that company was a publicly traded company. They said, hey, guys, please take it away. If you really push it in our direction on the table, we need to disclose it. So they were begging us to make an offer and rescue them from the Chinese giant. Okay, so this was the first time I met with kind of indirectly. And then I realized, okay, they're interested. Then we negotiated for several weeks, and then we broke on all kinds of reasons with the other company. And then the Chinese came back in. It was ChemChina. And they announced a transaction that they wanted to buy the company for even a higher price that we did not agree to pay. And they bought some time. They had 3 months to do exclusive due diligence. I remember I woke up at something like 4 a.m. because it was the last day of the deadline of their due diligence to see the announcement of the deal. And then I saw that they are not buying them also. So they dropped them out. After 3 months. So for me, it was a great celebration. And then I said, okay, let's try to get to know the enemy. So we organized a meeting in Beijing. This was in 2000, I think end of 2007. And some of our colleagues flew over to Beijing to a meeting with the president of ChemChina Group. And during that meeting, he said to our colleagues, we're actually more interested in buying you guys than buying the other company. So they came back and then started the whole series of meetings that took years between ChemChina and the then controlling shareholders of our group, IDP. And then in 2010, after several rounds with different, every time there was a different valuation, different debate, different this, different that. It took almost 3 years to strike the deal from the time we started the relationship until the deal was actually struck, with back and forth, and many times there was no discussion, no communication whatsoever. And the notion of how to do the deal evolved during the discussions. At the beginning, there was the thinking of the Chinese wanted to buy the whole company. The Israeli side did not want to sell the whole company. So there was a whole discussion as to how to do it. And then, of course, once it was clear that it will stay split, 60-40, then there was a discussion, okay, so ChemChina has some agrochemical operations outside of Adama. So there was this notion, okay, let's not compete, so put the these businesses inside. They agreed a certain valuation formula for when we actually do it. They said, let's take 3 years, allow the management of the company to select the right assets from within the ChemChina group, which we have now done. And of course, then to create the exit for the minority, the IPO was established. So this whole concept was part of the negotiations. I think for us, being refloated is, of course, very important for our distinctive identity. And we're now really in the final stages in the last year of this journey.
Don't you take quite a penalty in terms of multiple to be controlled by Chinese state?
We might. I say we might have all kinds of penalties. I think that always... The other way around, meaning?
You want 60% of the deal. I mean, the X part of the
okay. Yeah. I think that you get a penalty. If you're traded in the U.S., you'll get a penalty whatever ownership structure that you have, which is not fully distributed. So any controlling shareholder, all these notions of controlling shareholders is not something which helps your multiple. I think that from our perspective, having a controlling shareholder which is committed long-term to supporting our business and is providing to us an access to the Chinese market and committed to continue investing in the company in a significant way is very important. So I'd say probably not optimal from a multiple perspective, but I think from a strategic long-term perspective for our group, it's probably one of the best things that could have happened to us. I can say also for me personally, I was invited as deputy CEO of Adama to move over to Beijing. Last year I worked out of Beijing and I ran the strategic division of ChemChina, which is the China National Agrochemical Corporation that owns us. So basically, I don't think that if we would have been bought by BASF or DuPont or one of our German or American competitors that is much bigger than us, they would do the same.
Our
brand was the new brand was established in the next in the last couple of years, but before that we had you mean just the India brand?
Yeah,
right. Okay. So the notion here is we have operations in more than 50 countries. Each one of these operations used to invent its own name, or sometimes we acquired companies. So in India it was relatively straightforward because it was Mahteshi Magan India. Most people cannot even pronounce, not to mention spell, Mahteshi Magan. So, that's right. But I think in some of our other countries, Millennia, for example, in Brazil, has its own brand, not just a different name. And we bought first a company which was called Defensa in Brazil. Then we called another one which was called Herbitecnica. Then we merged the two into Millennia. Nothing to do with Mahteshi Magan, which was also a merger of two companies that nobody can pronounce its name. So essentially, we realize it doesn't make any sense, and we need to choose one simple name that people will get used to all over the world. So far, the feedback that we get from the market is excellent. So we're very happy with that, and most of our people are very happy, very connected to this name. They can pronounce it in a more easy way. And even in China, of course, in China, you know, every company has a different name in China than globally, each company. So Coca-Cola is called Coca-Cola, and everything has got a different name. So also our name in China is going to be An Mai Dao, so which is kind of close to Adama, but not just. So An Mai Dao has a meaning in Chinese, which is a safe way of conducting agriculture or growing things. So. No, there's a lot of thinking behind each name. By the way, my name, which you mentioned before, Chen is a very common name in China. So they said, but you're not Chen, you're Chen, right? So they invented for me, I'm called in Chinese Han Lin, which is a scholar, something different. It's not Chen.
But Chen is a surname.
That's right. It's the number one surname in China. So that's an interesting question. We've been debating the scope of our business many times. Of course, the center, the heart of the business is crop protection products. We are developing now, we set up Novel Agricultural Technologies division a few years ago, which is working on additional technologies way beyond agrochemicals, way beyond crop protection products. So things that we're looking at, and this does not mean necessarily that we're going to dive into, but things that we're looking at and developing, at least in a small scale, are seeds, seed technology, deployment, advanced deployment of fertilizers, smart irrigation, as you saw before, some of these drones, using drones to analyze in a relatively cost-effective way issues of either irrigation or diseases in big fields. So we're definitely considering expanding the breadth of our portfolio.
Are the prices in China for products are the same
like in other countries? It depends for which products and how they're positioned. The prices in China for high-end products, the distinctive products that are manufactured and typically provided by people from outside of China or perceived to be from outside of China, are about 40% higher, sometimes 50% higher than local products. But just to say, if you go to Beijing or Shanghai or any one of the hundreds of massive cities in China, you see that most of the cars in the streets these days are German make. So most of the growth of Volkswagen, of BMW, of all these companies is China. The cars are produced in Chinese plants, in joint ventures of these companies and local car makers, and they bear the same technology, same brand, same everything. They are all only larger. I don't know if you've seen, there is like the same cars that we're used to see all over the world with an L at the end, so bigger country, bigger cars, bigger everything. So that's the only difference. And you see that they like to pay. They're interested in paying for quality. So we believe also in our industry, if we position our products properly, it's not so important whether they are manufactured locally or not. The point is that they're made according to cutting edge technology, leading global quality approach, leading brand, global brand. And then it can be made in China, just like the cars, and you get a premium price.
Also in the agricultural market, because it's well known that the agricultural market in China is, let's say, poor. They don't like to pay. That one of the problems of all these big Israeli companies, like all of them, that was they face in China. So, if you're trying to compare your prices to the Chinese market,
what we sell today in China, which is still very small, is the same pricing as our pricing in other countries. So there is no issue. You can check with Prada, you can check with BMW, they get good prices. So the Chinese market is a very, very significant one, and it pays for quality. But of course, it's a question how to position the products, how to penetrate, how to gain registrations. There are lots of hurdles on the way to, there is huge regulation. So for example, in India, if you want to sell seeds, you develop your own type of seed, and it's pretty much you notify the government and you start selling. In China, you need to prove that your seed is one of the top yield enhancers in any given year. So you come with your seed, your new seed, and they say, well, show us that you can enhance yield. And they do field trials with your seeds, and they only pick the top three or top six each year for the country, and they give them nationwide license to add these seeds to the national offering. So if you're not as good as the top six, you're not there. So the level of regulation is much, much higher than in other markets. And that's one of the critical challenges now for us. Being part of a massive local player, we're as red as red can be. So we're controlled by central government, state-owned enterprise. You know, the government is a friend. So if we need to access the government, it's a phone call away from one of our colleagues in Beijing. So not that complicated. I'm not saying it's easy, but it's accessible. It makes a huge difference.
Okay.
and we have conversations with global companies much bigger than us that operate in China for many, many more years, and they have no way to figure out how to penetrate. For us, it's much more simple. The president of the group, president of ChemChina, is a level of a minister in the Communist Party. He's basically one of the 49 delegates to the National Congress that chooses the president and the Politburo of the country. So we're connected. Yes, it cost you some drinking to create it, but it's
so yes, shall we also protect you?
Please. How do you manage the gap between the state-owned company culture and the animal culture in the corporate?
Very good question. There are two distinct cultures, no doubt. I think that the interesting thing about ChemChina is that ChemChina was not established as a state-owned company. The president of the group started his own company as an entrepreneur and succeeded to grow the company significantly. And then the company was merged with some of the companies of the Ministry of Chemicals of the state. And then it became an SOE, a state-owned enterprise. So the heart of the company is not, it's not like typical Beijing bureaucrats. It's much more entrepreneurial and business orientated, and that's how they go to so many global partnerships. That's how they're connected with Blackstone. That's how they reached us. So we're quite fortunate from that perspective. This is not to say that it's the same culture. Two distinct cultures, but there is great interest in connecting, and that's why they invited me to go there. That's how they're operating with us today. They give us a lot of latitude, a lot of support. There was not a single dollar of dividend that was taken away from the company since they acquired the control.
Patrick, on that point of culture, but just speaking about the Chinese versus the Israeli, there's a lot of difference. It seems the next 3+ years there's going to be a great experience for yourself, the company, for Britain and Israel, to learn more on how to work with this other very large and growing economy that is China. Can you illustrate for us a few of the experiences of that working dynamic between two cultures of China and Israel, maybe?
Okay. One of the interesting experiences that I had when I was appointed to run our parent company was I came in and I thought that I'm going to change the management, change the way we do things, and then I was told, please go get some advice from HR consultant, which is itself a state-owned business. So I had two nice ladies come to my office, and they said to me, there is a procedure which is dictated by SESAC, so by the state ownership regulator, and it's called 3 keys, 1 major. According to this policy, everything which is above 5 million RMB, so it's less than $1 million, requires joint approval of the management of the company and the party organization of the company. So I came to realize that within my business, I have a shadow organization, which is a party organization, which is kind of auditing me all the time. And there is a person who is the head of the party, the Communist Party of China, not the party like dancing around. Head of the Communist Party of China organization within CNAC, within the China National Agrochemical Corporation that I'm running. And they said everything which is within 3 keys, 1 major, you need to do a joint meeting, management party, and there is a voting. And if you don't get the majority of the votes, you either give up or you go to the chairman to ask for him to overrule the decision of the joint committee. So I said, you know, this is not what I thought I'm coming for. I thought China is a, you know, CEO says something and everybody's doing it, right? So apparently that's not the case. So I had to work out, and this is a political issue. So a lot of people did not want to help me. I said, okay, I need to figure it out. I need to find a way around this. Because I cannot have this situation where there's voting on every little thing and I have a party and no party. And doesn't work. So firstly, I asked them whether I can just join the party. I said, you know. They were shocked. They were shocked. I must say they were shocked because Ken China brought in and many other state-owned enterprises tried to bring in hundreds of executives from the outside. I think I'm the most senior role that was ever appointed in China from the outside. But for other roles, there were many, many others. So I said, why don't I just join the party? They said, that we need to check it out. They were very concerned. And they came back to me after a week.
No way.
They said, no, you can join.
There's one Jew. There was the doctor of Mao. I mean, the physician of Mao who joined.
No, they said, you can join. You can join. However, the party is not the issue. The issue is the Chinese, to being Chinese citizen. Now, to become a Chinese citizen, you need to give away your other citizenships. So I said, all right. I love my country. No way. So that was taken off the table. And then, because if you're a party member, you can do both roles. They call it, there is a little saying that you basically take, like it's you have two buckets. And that kind of keeps you balanced because you take care of the party and you take care of the business. So if I would have been a party member, I could do both roles. I can be the CEO and also the party head. So that didn't work. Then I said, okay, let's do something different. And what we worked out was a procedure. I said, all management meetings, the party is invited to all of them. I said, I work for the party. I want to be a member of the party. The party is running the state. The party owns everything. I invite the party to all management meetings on a regular basis. So there is no more discussion if it's a joint meeting of the party and the management or not. It's always a joint discussion. That was the first thing that we did. And then I said, my only position, the only thing which is unique to the CEO is you're the moderator of the discussion. That's it. The moderator. Everything else is voting. So I said, all right. So, you need to prepare things in advance. You need to submit materials a week earlier for people to read, and then there is voting. So I said, okay, I'm only the moderator. So every person who wants to raise a topic, raise a matter for discussion, I allow them to mention the matter. And then at the end of the discussion, there's open discussion without submitting anything. And then at the end of the discussion, I, as a moderator, will dictate to the note taker a proposed decision. It's just a proposal. It's not a decision. And then I open it up. There is minutes. The minutes are published. They are sent by email to everyone, including the party members. And they have a week to say that they go against my proposal. And then if they go against the proposal, the following week we have another meeting. And then we will open it up for a vote. So basically, I went according to the rules, 100%. There was not a single time that anyone ever objected to my proposals. So basically, I said, if there is no objection, after a week, it becomes automatically a binding decision of the joint committee. So now everybody in Camp China is copying the... Okay. Language barrier is very significant. Most of the...
All the time.
Yeah. So there are people who speak English, but I realize that the most important, most capable people in the CNAC organization were actually the ones who are dedicated party members, quite old, excellent in what they do. They know their stuff, they have a lot of relationships, but they don't speak a word of English. And they're extremely loyal. They are loyal to the system, they were loyal to me. So I worked a lot with interpreters. In fact, most of the people who spoke English, I didn't keep around me because they were much less loyal, much less focused, more kind of trying to make nice presentations. So I went for the party members. And they became very loyal to me. And of course, I had to use interpreters. So you need to choose very carefully who joins you for meetings. Now, there are lots of good things about it. Because when you have this interpretation, it makes you much more calm. Because if you get agitated, the interpreter does not. So it doesn't really come across. You know, you get agitated, but then the interpreter is kind of very dull. So no reason to make the whole thing, right? So just stay calm. And the Chinese, in any case, they are not, it doesn't really work the same way as it does outside of China. The second thing is you have time to think. You know, you have the time to think all the time. So you're much more brief and you are much more thoughtful about every sentence that you take out because it needs to work through someone, right? So also when you are in meetings, I have somebody sitting next to me and whispering in my ear. Every time when I want to say something, I think twice because it's going to stop the whole flow of the discussion. Is it that important? Most cases, it's not. So you speak less, the meetings are shorter, much more focused. No, no. There are many good things about it. So I can say I'm sometimes even thinking in conversations these days, wow, I would have died to have some interpretation here. Just to let me think a bit more.
Huh? Yeah, you know, they speak English, but you may declare that you don't speak Hebrew anymore. So that's what they, many of them do. Okay. I'd like to pose, we're getting to the end and we'd like to finish on time, but you know, there's a echoing, you know, we've been to India, and Yossi Goldschmidt has made the introduction. And you know, you probably know the song of the Mahashimagan India.
Yes, right? Of course. And
so, for those who don't know, I don't know if that appears in this. It's a Kol Ha'olam Kulo Gesher Tzar Me'od, and you should see the Indian sing Kol Ha'olam Kulo Gesher Tzar Me'od, which is a sort of bizarre experience.
You know,
the point that I want to bring up, and that's sort of echoing my discussion with Professor Zev Hirsch about the Israeliness of the company, okay? I don't know if it's relevant anymore, but you know, if you look at Mahashimagan India, you know, they're, you know, the anthem is Kol Ha'olam Kulo Gesher Tzar Me'od, the Indians are singing that in a very strange way, and so on. There's a notion that is a very Israeli company, both in terms of the model, you know, taking sandals and going to the field and speaking to farmers, which, you know, your competitors do not do, okay? Which to us, when we visited the company, suggested that, you know, in Africa, everybody's looking at Africa, would be a very interesting model to follow, okay? It's a big question, but, you know, could you make a comment about how Israeli you see Adama in
China
a couple of years when, you know, production in China may become more attractive than in Ramat Chobab? Will you see yourself shifting to other places? And I'm talking about Nuva and Klal in the background of my question.
So first of all, you should see the Chinese when you start singing Katyushka after a few drinks. They sob. So, they love it. It's like, it's very funny with the Chinese after you have a few of these,
Maotai.
Maotai is 54% alcohol.
I survived the 96.
So you drink in very small cups. And after a few of them, you become very happy, and then everyone stands up and starts singing songs. So these songs of the old communist linkage that we have between Israel and this works really well. In any case, I think that in many ways, China has got huge respect to Israel, as I mentioned before, and this is why Tel Aviv University, the Technion, are able to create fascinating joint ventures with Chinese universities. The same applies to our industry, which we of course cultivate. Everyone says to me, regions, of course, yes, everything is correct. I'm not sure if Marx was 100% Jewish or not, but we embrace everything. So basically, I think that the interesting thing about China is that they accommodate us much more than they accommodate other cultures because we're much less of a threatening culture. We're much more easy to integrate with, to connect with, and this works quite well. It's not as straightforward as with as in India because of the language barrier, but I think it works quite well. I think that for us, as long as we maintain the technological advantage, the kind of mindset, business advantage of Israel, we will do well. We will do well as a global company, we will do well within China. Of course, things shift, things change, and it could be that within, I don't know, decades, the company will be less Israeli, but it's not necessarily a bad thing. It's part of the way the world runs, right? I think I don't know exactly the terms of the Tnuva or Klal situations. The only thing I can say is from our experience, it's a huge benefit, huge benefit. And I think for a company like Tnuva that is an industrial company, pretty much a saturated market in Israel, to have the opportunity through with the backing of a state-owned enterprise to go into China, I think they tried to go to some small markets in Central Europe with, let's say, varying level of success. I think the opportunity to go into China with their technologies of what can be, how milk can be processed and sold, can be a huge opportunity for them. And at least to the best of our experience, it's a great thing.
Okay. Yeah, I think that's a wonderful way to conclude the meeting of you know, the Center for Global Business. You know, the looking at the positive side of that. Chen, as we know him, that's actually, I want to recognize this is your first sort of public appearance, and we appreciate the honor that you sort of bestowed upon us.
All because of Yossi.
As a token of appreciation, I'd like to present you
thank
with
you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay.
Toda.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And with that, I suggest we adjourn, and we will meet you next year.